Thank you very much, Major, for a very kind invitation. So, as Major said, over the next 20 minutes, we'll just discuss other preventative measures for sudden cardiac death in athletic individuals. So, as Professor Sharma mentioned already, there is no doubt that exercise is beneficial for everyone, whether they're healthy or whether they've got cardiovascular disease. And also, there is no doubt that there is an increasing trend of people who take on exercise. And these are the number of individuals that completed at least one foot race, being a 5K or a marathon in the United States. And you can see the increase from about 2.5 million to almost 20 million from 1990 to 2013. And that's going to be a continuously increasing trend. So we're going to see more and more individuals who want to participate in regular exercise, irrespective of whether they are competitive amateur athletes or individuals who want to get fitter. This is another diagrammatic approach to the cause of sudden cardiac death in young individuals, which is quite relevant. And as you can see, the cardiomyopathies that Professor Sharma mentioned are in purple, the cardiomyopathies in red, and the atherosclerosis of coronary heart disease in yellow. And you can clearly see that if we discuss in young athletes, which is predominantly the group that Professor Sharma was referring to, then the inherited or congenital causes are more frequent, but as you go past the age of 35, then there is no competition and ischemic heart disease becomes the predominant factor. And that's particularly relevant when we discuss how do we prevent screening in athletic individuals, whether they've got an inherited condition or they've got an acquired condition. And that is reflected to the screening methodology and the screening strategies that are proposed for the two different groups. And Professor Sharma primarily referred to the young competitive athletes, where you have to put the history, the physical examination, and the 12-lead ECG. But if you look at the more advanced age athletic individuals, more than 35 essentially, then you see that within that history, we've got the risk score to try and detect the risk of coronary artery disease. And also, if there is an abnormality, then the recommendation, which is somewhat debatable, is about the maximal exercise testing and then further investigations. But as we recognized earlier in the lecture, the fact remains that irrespective of what sort of screening that you do and what you use, pre-participation screening has a number of limitations. So on its own, it's not going to prevent sudden cardiac death. And there are other complementary strategies on top of pre-participation screening that can help us do that. And as Professor Sharma said, it's not going to do that on its own because we've got a false negative rate, and it's important to recognize that. So for example, in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, up to 98% of individuals have an abnormal ECG, which is clearly not the case with arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, which can be as low as 40 or 50%. Also, very poor detection rate for any coronary artery disease. Coronary artery anomalies in the young and coronary ischemic heart disease in the older individuals. And also, don't forget some novel entities that we've just started exploring, like the notion of idiopathic left ventricular hypertrophy and idiopathic fibrosis that I will refer to later in my lecture. And this is the study that earlier Professor Sharma mentioned from my group of about 360 deaths in athletic individuals, amateur and professional athletes. First of all, note that not all of them die during exercise, and you will expect that. But the important message here was we tried to see if there was an association between the conditions that they had and whether they died during exercise or at rest. And there were some conditions like arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy that, remember, we mentioned up here, the coronary artery anomalies, and that idiopathic fibrosis that made athletic individuals highly more likely to die during exercise, with individuals with ARVC being 6 times more likely to die during active exercise compared to the rest of the group. So individuals who had hypertrophic cardiomyopathy or a normal heart defined as sudden arrhythmic death syndrome. So, what are the alternative strategies? This is a large study from the United States. This is a study on about 2,000 sudden cardiac arrests. This is not just in sportsmen, that's everyone included. And essentially, what they try to identify, whether there was any relation between collapse and defibrillation to survival, and I know it doesn't seem like rocket science now, but essentially what they said, so this is your probability of surviving to hospital discharge, this is the time to defibrillation, and these are the time intervals that CPR was started at 1 minute, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and 15 minutes. And the take-home messages from this slide is that if you start CPR too late, so past 10 minutes, and keep that mark of 10 minutes, then irrespective of how early you defibrillate, it's unlikely that they're going to survive. You can see that the line from then on becomes fairly flat. On the other hand, even if you start your CPR very early, within a minute, if you pass 10 minutes when you offer defibrillation to that individual who's in the air, again, the line is fairly flat, so you miss that window of opportunity. And also remember that for every minute that goes past, after the collapse and the VFRS, then you lose about 7 to 10% chance of surviving to hospital discharge. So that 10-minute time interval is very, very relevant. And that has been confirmed, so the effectiveness of automated external defibrillators essentially has been confirmed in a number of studies. This is a study by Jonathan Drosner in about 1,700 high school athletes. And they studied retrospectively with questionnaires about 36 sudden cardiac arrests that happened in those particular schools over the 6 month period. And what they identified is, first of all, obviously, in a school environment, like the same in an arena environment, not all cardiac arrests are going to be athletic individuals. You've got other individuals around, whether they're teachers, coaches, or individuals visiting that particular venue. So 14 in athletic individuals, 22 in non-students. Very important, the majority of them were witnessed, and almost 95% in both cases were started CPR very promptly, so they had bystander CPR. And look at those times, within 1.5 minutes and less than a minute for non-athletic individuals. Another very important message is that more than 90% or almost 90% in both groups received an AED stop. And again, I'll point out the times within 1.8 minutes of collapse and 3.6 minutes of collapse. Very, very quick, bystander CPR, and very quick defibrillation. And that would give them a 64% survival rate to hospital discharge. Now, if we go to a more general population study, this is a large 5-year study from France by Marie et al. And they studied cardiac arrest during sports, so on exercise. Obviously, those are not competitive athletes, those are athletic individuals of all ages or individuals who participate in sport of all ages. 90% recreational sport, very important message. 95% male, remember what you had before, that the majority of sudden cardiac tests do occur in males, and the participation rates in different sports does not on its own justify that high prevalence compared to females. But again, if you look at the reported on 820 sudden deaths, the mean age here was 46 years, and only 6% were competitive. The majority were witnessed, but only, unfortunately, 31% received bystander CPR, which is probably what you would expect to find in a general population sort of scenario, rather than high school athletic individuals. Look at the 4.8 minutes, and 60% received an AED shock, but that was during a mean time of 12.5 minutes, which is quite late already. And that's what gave them that 16%, okay? But they also noted that if you look at different parts of the country, where bystander CPR had a high percentage and earlier defibrillation, then the maximum survival rate they could achieve was over 50%. So it's something similar to what Drezner mentioned. But having the automated external defibrillator on site alone does not help with anything unless you've got a very organized plan as to what you're going to do when the cardiac arrest happens. Okay? And I couldn't find a better quote than what Benjamin Franklin said, that by failing to prepare, you're definitely preparing to fail. There is no way you're going to succeed to resuscitate someone unless you know what you're doing and unless you're doing it repeatedly. So what you need to have, you need to have a very organized emergency response plan in your arena or your school, Well, you've got the right personnel, that is straight. You've got a good communication system. You know where your AED is, and you know that the battery is charged, otherwise there is no point of having it. And also, very importantly, you practice and review that process so you develop a vision of automaticity of what's the next step when the cardiac arrest happens. And remember that even if you acquire a skill and you don't practice it for a year, then 90% of individuals will essentially have lost that skill. So you need to repeat the same process again and again and again. Now, I always debate what I'm going to show those videos, but I think they're very useful. This is a very good, sorry, this is a very bad scenario of resuscitation, and this is Mark Vivian Ford, and this is a very good scenario with Fabrice Mamba. I just let it play for a couple of minutes, and I think it's obvious why this scenario is very tragic, and this is a good scenario, and I'll just talk in just a second. So, as you know, Mark Vivian Ford collapsed in the stadium, and unfortunately, he passed away. You can see the resuscitation efforts that are performed, which is not very much. And Fabrice Mwamba, you've all seen that on TV. Again, he collapsed during a Tottenham game. And in his case, he was fortunate enough in that there was an organized plan and there were the right individuals to do the right stuff at the right time. Also, you will notice in both videos that diagnosing cardiac arrest can be quite challenging because you can't have abnormal respiration, so it seems that the individual is still trying to breathe, and they can be quite strong and resisting because they've got like a fitting sort of action. So it can be quite difficult to turn them around. But the point, the two points I'm going to make is one, that you see they've got him on the stretcher, they just do that sort of thing, and they try to get him off the staging, okay? Even if you look carefully at the cameraman, they're focusing on the other players and they're focusing on the coach as well. Here, they started CPR at about 1 minute and 5 seconds, and they're getting ready to defibrillate the athletic individual, okay? And that's why we have two very, very different outcomes. So, Mark Vivian Foy passed away, Fabrice Mwamba returned to the same stadium after a few months. And the time from collapse to CPR for Fabrice was 1.07 minutes, and from to first shock was 2 minutes and 21 seconds. Now, if we need an organized response plan, how well are we doing in Europe? And I don't mean for you to read all this table. This is the data from the ARENA study that was performed by our group in sports cardiology. And essentially what they did, they sent lots of questionnaires to football clubs, and these are probably the most elite football clubs around Europe. So those are the best results we could possibly get. And the last question as to whether there is an AED every time there is a match or every time the players train. And you can see that the response was 72%, ranging from 0 in Serbia and 38 in Sweden to 100% in Italy and Norway. They were also asked if there is a documented medical response plan, and again, the average was about 60% with large variations. About the appropriate communication system, and I think that's a bit more difficult question to answer, but anyway, in the great majority of clubs, they had an appropriate communication system in case of cardiac arrest. And another thing that we lack a bit behind is whether they were providing basic life support training for their staff that were supposed to respond to a cardiac arrest. And just to give you an idea as to what's happening here in the UK, and that is our unpublished data from our group and Anil Malhotra that kindly donated the slide. And essentially what he did the same similar sort of thing like the ARENA study with the collaboration of the FA and the Footballers Association. And they got data from 60 clubs in different divisions. The availability of AED was 100%, as it should be, in football matches, whether there was proper match or training. And then you can see it was split in Premiership, Championship, First Division, and Secondary Division. And if you look at the emergency action plan, again, the majority of clubs will have an emergency action plan, also there is work still to be done. And training for the staff for AED, well, it approached 100% for Premiership and a bit lower in the rest of the divisions. And also the other thing that they do is that there is, in the majority of cases, an ambulance on site should something happen to that particular player. So these are encouraging data, so there is still work to be done. Now, a couple of important points that I suspect most of them you know them better than me, but some challenges that you face when you've got an emergency response plan is, for example, the away games. So when you play your own arena, you know what your equipment is, you know what you have to deal with, and you've got your organization, but when you go away, it's a bit more challenging, and you have to investigate what's the local equipment, who is the local team that you have to work with, and obviously the local facilities and expertise of particular hospitals, for example, in the area, whether you've got a cardiac arrest or a spinal injury. Remember, it's not all about athletes. It's more likely that you will have a cardiac arrest in a spectator than an athletic individual, so they need to be protected. They will be the majority of individuals in your stadium or your game. And very, very important, reflective practice. So every single incident of sudden cardiac death is an opportunity to get better. It's an opportunity to improve your emergency response plan, and it's also an opportunity to think of the family of that particular individual who passed away, and also to think what are the further investigations that need to happen to ensure that the same tragedy not only doesn't happen in your stadium, but doesn't happen in the family of that particular individual, and I'll explain in a second. So it's very important to remember that sudden cardiac death in young athletic individuals, and this is from our cohort, can be because of inherited or congenital abnormalities, okay? So you can have cardiomyopathies, you can have the coronary artery anomalies, and you can have that big bunch of a normal heart. And what does a normal heart mean? The assumption we're making is that a normal heart means that there is an electrical fault of the heart. Professor Sharma mentioned Brugada syndrome, LOQT syndrome, CPVT. And this has been confirmed in a number of studies where, based on the inheritance of these conditions, they've taken first-degree family relatives of the deceased and they've screened them for all those conditions. And as you can see, they've been identifying ion channelopathies such as Brugada, LOQT syndrome, and CPVT. So this is a very important message, okay? And it's important to remember that when an athletic individual, any young individual dies, the family has to go through all this journey, and hopefully, eventually, they will end up with a specialist cardiologist if there is a suspicion of an inherited condition, or to put it in another way, if there is no definitive evidence that what kills that particular individual is not inherited in any way. Who helps them out? In the United Kingdom, we are quite lucky. We've got a charity that we work very closely together called Cardiac Risk in the Young. And that charity provides guidance to the family, bereavement support. There is a support network all around the UK. And it also supports our cardiac pathology unit at St. George's University Hospital and our intended cardiac diseases clinic. And essentially what CRI will do is it will provide the finances for the part of the individual who passed away to come to our expert center so we can examine it quickly, take the right samples, give our expert opinion, and then repatriate it to be buried with the disease. Is an expert cardiac pathologist necessary? And why do we get into the trouble? And the answer is that it is absolutely necessary because those conditions, they are relatively rare compared to coronary artery disease, and they can be very difficult to diagnose, particularly in athletic individuals. So, for example, athletes can get left ventricular hypertrophy, but left ventricular hypertrophy is the hallmark of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy as well, and you need to be able to differentiate one from the other. And very importantly, the result of the postmortem will guide the clinician as how to investigate that particular family. Am I looking for a cardiomyopathy and I do an ECG and an echo, or am I looking for an ion channelopathy because there is normal heart or findings of uncertain significance and I'm going to do a more comprehensive evaluation? And this is an example of a study we did in 160 consecutive sudden cardiac deaths. This is the opinion of the general pathologist. This is what happened when our pathologist had a look. And you can see that there is quite a bit of difference of opinion. And the majority of what the general pathologist assigned to cardiomyopathy became a normal fat and sudden arrhythmic TET syndrome when our pathologist had a look at the fat. In essence, he said, I can't see enough evidence to name it RVC or hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, so please look for everything when you see the family. That's the message. And this is again reiterated in that study that we published in 2013, where we looked at a number of conditions that can be confused for myocarditis, for example, or as I said, for cardiomyopathy, like hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. But we felt that that was not the case. There was a bit of LVH, but there was no myocardial disarray in the myocardium. And if you screen the family relatives, you can identify a significant proportion of them who have an iron channelopathy, which is a very important message. And this is a victim with a diagnosis of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and autopsy. There is hypertrophy, but there is no myocardial disarray in the myocytes. Okay? They're very nicely packed. But look what we found when we did the 12-lead ECG in the exercise test. You've got the classic Brugada pattern in two of the relatives. So you can see now the difference between diagnosing HCM compared to diagnosing Brugada syndrome. And we do a one-stop shop clinic that we attend to see all the relatives from different corners of the UK within our clinic. They will undergo comprehensive evaluation and will make sure that nothing was missed in the past. This is an individual who was admitted with gastroenteritis and fever. That was his ECG, but nobody looked at it. So they missed the opportunity to diagnose Brugada syndrome. This is a comprehensive evaluation that we will perform, and I won't refer to it in detail. But as I said, it makes a difference whether we're looking for HCM or whether we've got a normal heart and we're looking for an iron channelopathy. And this is the yield that we get, which is similar to other studies. So in 50% of normal hearts, we will identify conditions, predominantly an iron channelopathy in first-degree relatives. And the important thing is that you can do something about it, being lifestyle modification advice to the implantation of an intracardiac defibrillator. So in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, young standard cardiac death can be prevented, and we have to have a number of complementary strategies. And young standard cardiac death, because it's frequently inherited, it provides a unique opportunity to identify other family relatives who are asymptomatic, and sudden cardiac death in their case may also be the first presentation. And remember that when you've got a normal heart at postmortem, that does not mean that you haven't got a disease. That means you need to do more comprehensive evaluation. And just to finish off, if you're interested in sports cardiology, I'll do a bit of advertising. Just join me in CPR, and also we're creating a master's degree in sports cardiology that we're hoping that Bassem will also join us for. Thank you very much for your attention.